Hi there, Jim Leach here from our Wisehart Family Singer team. Hoping that all of our veterans, my beloved Marines, as well as the soldiers and sailors and airmen who have all faithfully served our country and in each of your time, hoping that each of you had a wonderful Veterans Day this last week and that the Lord blesses you for your service as well as blesses you and your families throughout this next year. God bless you and thank you.
No spring chicken. That's the first thing my neighbor said to me when I told her I was pregnant. Can you believe that? Maybe she just didn't believe me, but I don't hold it against her. She'd been a tad bit cranky ever since she found that scorpion in her girdle drawer. Maybe she just didn't realize what a miracle this was for me. I mean, Zachariah and I had been trying to have a child of our own our whole lives. By the time most of my hair had turned gray and Zachariah's had turned loose, we had given up hope. But nothing is impossible for God. He seems to delight in making life out of barren places. And as if that wasn't enough, the angel who brought us this unbelievable news had even more to say. This child, our son, would be used by God to prepare the people for the coming of the Messiah. This was all too much of a gift to be real. And then I thought, well, how am I going to train this child for a job like that? Had those details covered too. And it keeps getting better. When I was about 6 months along, my cousin Mary came for a visit. And no sooner had she said hello than this unborn son jumped and flipped inside of me. Right then, God just opened my eyes so that I could clearly see that this young girl standing in my home was also with child, and he would be called Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. About 9 months later, we got the news from Bethlehem. And I looked over at Zachariah holding our very own miracle baby. I had one of those God moments. You know, when you just realize, you say, God just had different plans. He had brought us life in barren places. He hadn't forgotten about us. And he would never leave us alone again.
Seated among us, Let every heart receive him now, where there is praise, he will inhabit, and there will be grace and mercy all around. Every bird will be lifted in his presence. Every trophy will be laid down at his feet. There is a name that reigns above all others, Jesus Christ, the King above all.
Unto the Lamb, honor and glory, worthy is he who overcame, buried in shame, risen in power. He is alive, and the stone is rolled.
Thank you.
Hi, friends and family. Welcome to the Wisehart Family Singers Chapel Hour, and welcome to the most wonderful time of the year. We're entering into the Christmas season, and my name is Jim Leach. I am helping Dad and filling in a little during this season, and today you get the second string, so welcome. We love having you to be with us this time and this year. Isn't it a joy to have Christmas upon us, to start hearing the carols in the stores and at home and being played on the radio? And don't you just love all the decorations? My bride, Rebecca, is a queen of decorating for Christmas, and it always just fills. Actually, she decorates all through the year, and it fills our home with color and light and just a lot of fun. But Christmas isn't just a fun time of year with presents, although I like presents, and music, I like the music, and family and friends. I also believe it's an important time of year. I think it's actually strategic for the church and for the world. This is a time when people will be hearing again about our Savior's birth. They'll hear it in stories, and they'll hear it in songs, and it just may be that this is the one time in the year that some people might actually stop and think about it, or stop and open their hearts to hearing more about that little baby Jesus in the manger than at any other time of year. So today, I want to start off our Christmas season with an alert for us to start preparing ourselves for Christ's coming again. And I want us to start getting ready to help answer people's questions when the Holy Spirit cracks their hearts open, even if it's only for this short season of Christmas. So today I want to talk about preparing the way for Jesus and preparing ourselves to experience Him again in an even deeper and in a new way, different than we've ever done it before, but also in preparing ourselves to help Him reach people and help people see that Jesus this year is their Messiah and their Savior. So my message today is about the signs that God has given us to prepare the world for Christ's birth, and the signs we can share with people and point to as reasons why we believe in Jesus still today. I believe it's important for every follower of Christ to not only be ready, but be equipped and prepared to tell people, why do you believe what you believe? Why would you put faith in someone who lived 2,000 years ago and died? And why do you have a hope for tomorrow? And why is Christmas any more than just a cool story, like Santa Claus is a kind of cool story? And for Christians to be effective during this time of year, I think it's worthwhile to stop and sharpen our edge and remember and even prepare ourselves with the whys we believe what we believe, so that when those moments come up, whether it's a neighbor or a friend, and they see us celebrating Christmas, and maybe they're just wondering, maybe they don't even ask the question. I love telling people, oh, I'm glad you asked that question, when they never ask the question, because I'm a little bit maybe obnoxious. But even if you think they're wondering why, you can say, have you ever wondered why we believe this? And many, I think, are open during this strategic time of year to hearing the story of God's love in a way that they're not through the rest of the year, and maybe they haven't anywhere before in their lives up to this moment. So my message today is going to be focusing in on the signs that God gave us and the signs God used to prepare the world for Christ's birth. And I believe they are tools that we can use to share with people and to point to as our reasons why we believe in Jesus today. And while my text
is going to represent what I believe is the single strongest sign, I also want to very quickly cover the large field of, I mean, like neon bright, I mean, fireworks exploding kind of signs, comets kind of, you know, signs like that God gave us to help us find our Savior, to identify and find our Savior. So God sent and gave us angels to confirm and to announce Jesus's birth. Mary, Joseph, Zechariah, and the shepherds, they all got told in very no uncertain terms by some rather impressive, probably big, I'd be scared, scary looking, powerful messengers of God Almighty that Jesus, the Messiah, was coming to them and for us. And on top of that, God gave us a star to confirm in the heavens that Jesus' birth was here and now, so that men of God far and wide could have a chance to seek him and find him for themselves. Do you realize, and I've thought about this a little bit, that for God to have that star on the right place in the right time, he had to have put that star in place and on track during the creation of the universe. And he had to have it timed precisely to make that sign happen correctly. And so the star that God gave us, it's a sign, it's a proof for inquiring minds. I don't think God expects us to be mindless and blind believers. Now, faith is important. And he tells us without faith, it's impossible to please him. We have to believe that he is and that he cares about us and that he rewards those who seek him. But he also made us creatures of intelligence, and he gave us proofs and reasons to say, I can see that. I can't see it all. I don't understand it all. His ways are way bigger than Jim will ever get. But, you know, he gave me reasons that I can think about, and they line up and they're correct and they're consistent. And so I believe the star that he gave us in that beautiful Christmas story is part of the signs that confirm Jesus. I don't remember anybody else having, you know, a sign like that announce and affirm the correctness or the importance of a baby's birth anywhere in history before or since. So the sign is another, or the star is another one of the signs, I believe, that God gave us. And God gave us prophecies. Dozens of men of God, inspired by the Holy Spirit, recorded many details and facts about the coming Messiah, about his birth and his life and his death. And many men were informed by God of a little part of Jesus' story, but very specific parts with details that God presented to us in prophecies through the Holy Spirit. And many of these prophecies were written hundreds and even thousands of years in advance of Christ's birth. So this isn't just a short window, a burst of revelation. No, God had planned it, and God had prepared it, and God had begun to plant his signs for us throughout the Old Testament over hundreds and thousands of years that would all help us understand that Jesus was the one. Several sources that I've read and that I have found, they list or they cite over 300 separate prophecies in the Old Testament that Jesus directly fulfilled. And there's not a single one that I know of that he hasn't fulfilled, other than those that come at the end of time. And so, again, hundreds and thousands of years ago, God moved dozens of people to give us additional proofs and signs in the Old Testament that Jesus was the one they told us about his birth. They told us about his life, where he would live, where he would grow up, how God would move through him, his ministry. And Jesus faithfully fulfilled every one of them. And so, in addition to these, God also gave us eyewitnesses to Christ's miraculous birth and his supernatural and loving nature. Joseph and Mary reported what Jesus did and what God did through Christ. The wise men and the shepherds were eyewitnesses, and their testimonies, again, confirm the prophecies and confirm the rightness of God's love. Simeon the priest and the godly woman Anna, two of my favorites at the temple, they were eyewitnesses that God's promise has been fulfilled, and this is the one, this is the Messiah here, God with us, the baby Jesus. And his disciples and other New Testament writers, who all saw firsthand the amazing work of the baby Jesus grown into the fullness of God Almighty here with us, right here with us. The Bible says he'll be called Emmanuel, which is God right here with us. And God gave my bride, Rebecca, and me an amazing experience when we met a little Vietnamese lady. We met her walking up and down Mount Rubido, which is more of a hill than a mountain, but it's a beautiful walk. And at the top of Mount Rubido is a cross. And we met this little Vietnamese lady as we walked up and down the hill for, you know, just exercise and the enjoyment of being outside. And we would walk up to the cross. And we noticed that someone regularly put fresh flowers at the foot of the cross. We never knew who it was until one day we saw her picking wild flowers along the side of the road. And we stopped and we said, "Are you the one who puts flowers at the foot of our Savior's cross?" And she smiled and she said, "Yes." And her English wasn't the best, but she told us her story. And in Riverside, California, where we were living at that time. And this lady told us her story about meeting Jesus, an eyewitness in the here and now today. She saw Jesus appear to her, and he spoke her name. And at the time, she had never heard his name spoken. She was a Vietnamese in that part of the world, and she had never heard the name of Jesus. She had never been taught the Christian story, but a man appeared to her, called her by her name in her native language, and told her that he loved her. And she told us, and his hands were bleeding, and he treated me like no man has ever treated me, and I didn't even know who he was until later, when she was able to emigrate out of Vietnam. And as she came to America, she heard the story of Jesus. And she said, "I saw him. He appeared to me. He talked to me. He told me, no man had ever told me that they loved me, but he told me that he loved me. And his hands were bleeding. And he was different than anybody I have ever met." And for Rebecca and I, we received even the eyewitness testimony of a modern day, at the time, not believer, but just a woman who God loved, who he appeared to. And again, the New Testament writers and the disciples and Jesus's parents and all of those who have recorded their testimonies to us help to confirm, along with the other signs, the prophecies and the star and all of these things God has given us as gifts and signs as to why we can believe, why we don't have to just, you know, blindly accept what somebody has told us. We do have to exercise faith in this process, but he also gives us proofs. He also gives us reasons to believe. And for us, that wonderful lady, she told us her name. I've forgotten her name. She was just nice and sweet, and forever after she learned who he was, she found every way she could to show her love and gratitude for him. And while we climbed Mount Rubido, one of the ways that she was faithful in giving her eyewitness testimony was by putting fresh flowers at the foot of the cross. It wasn't the cross of Calvary in Jerusalem. It's a cross in Riverside, California, in this park. But it represented Jesus and what he had done. And her love for him led her to just almost daily put new fresh flowers to honor him. So eyewitnesses are some of the signs that God has given us in our faith journeys to reaffirm and to encourage us to go ahead and believe. And so all of these signs, I think, are important for us. But none of them are the ones that I chose as my text and as what I think might be the most important sign confirming Jesus. And that sign would come from the story of John the Baptist and when Jesus was baptized. And my text is found in Matthew chapter 3. We're going to read verses 1 through 17 together. And you're welcome to read it in your Bibles at home, but I believe it's going to be on the screen also. And so if you want to turn to that and join me, Matthew chapter 3, we're going to start off with verse 1. And it goes, "In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the desert of Judea and saying, 'Repent.'" And the word repent mostly means turn around, stop going in that direction and change your direction. Repent, stop, and come this way. And so he says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." And then in verse 3, "This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, a voice of one calling in the desert, 'Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him.'" Verse 4, "John's clothes were made of camel's hair," sounds a little itchy to me, "and he had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. And people went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River." Continuing in verse 7, "But when he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees coming to where he was baptized, he said to them, 'You brood of vipers,'" yikes, "'who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not think you can say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire.'" Verse 11. And then he says, "I baptize you with water for repentance. Now listen here. But after me will come one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I'm not even fit to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire." Verse 13. "Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him, saying, 'I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?' And Jesus replied, 'Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this to fulfill all righteousness.' Then John consented." Verse 16. "And then as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. And at that moment, heaven opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, 'This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am very well pleased.'" So, why do you think that God gave us so many and such dramatically clear, unmistakable signs that this baby, this man was the one? I mean, in addition to the eyewitnesses and the prophecies and the star and the angels, God himself steps into the lineup. God himself tells us personally, specifically, this one of all men that have ever lived, ever walked the earth, this one is my son. This is the one. You ever think about that? God, he's all power. He's amazing. But he steps into the story personally, the Holy Spirit descends down visibly, and God, on top of everything else, more, very much the icing on the cake, gives us the best proof, the best testimony he would know, and he for sure can be trusted to tell us right. And he says, don't miss it. Jesus is the one. He is my Messiah. He is my promise coming true to you, my Christmas gift to you. And God himself joins our signs, our reasons to believe in Jesus and to put our faith in him. I believe the reason why God would do this is, so very simply, we wouldn't miss Jesus. God doesn't want anyone to miss Jesus. God has given us all these hundreds of powerful, unmistakable, and perfectly intersecting signs. I can just picture them all crisscrossing right on the head of Jesus, so that, I mean, none of them even just close or nearby, but every single one of them exactly identifying Jesus, this one, and this one, and this one, and the star, and the prophecies, I mean, the hundreds of prophecies, and the eyewitnesses, and God's very own testimony. He gives us all of these things just so that we couldn't miss him. I also believe that God gave us all these signs to prepare us for his coming. God wanted and still wants to prepare people's hearts to receive him. God doesn't just want us to know about Jesus. God wants us to join in with Jesus, to receive him, to have Jesus enter our lives and our hearts, and for Jesus to live, God, right here with me, and Jesus in my heart. And I believe God still wants our minds, he gave us these minds, to have a strong belief and faith in him, based in truth. And he gives us plenty of truths and evidence that we can lean on, especially during times, hard times, times of doubt. We're human. He knows that. He knows what we need. And one of the things I've always loved to take note of is that God delights in giving us what we need instead of what I deserve. And that is very much a definition of grace that I love. But here again, God knows what we need, and so he gives us exactly what we need to believe in him. And God still wants to prepare our spirits and our wills to bow before him and to receive our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So all of that brings me to my big idea. My mom blessed her, woman of God, she would often say, what's the big idea, Jim? So my big idea today is this. The Christmas story hasn't changed. And God still wants on earth today, everyone on earth today, and everyone we know to find and to listen to and to believe in his son, Jesus, in whom he is so well pleased. So what would you say we do with this? Well, my application reads this way. People, we, the Church of Jesus Christ, need to be ready this Christmas to both individually receive and respond to our Savior again. And we also need to be ready to help point others, lead others to our baby Jesus, who also is their Savior and the King of Kings. Now, I'm real, I'm human, I often have to respond to my own altar calls. If this means that I have to repent again for something to prepare myself for this time with Jesus, then so be it. It's for my own good, I know. And if this means I need to make room afresh and anew for the baby Jesus in my heart, so be it. That's God's message to me again this year, as it is every year. And so, if you, as a believer in Jesus, if the Lord is speaking to you, then take this opportunity to just pause and say, Lord, your will be done. And guide me and help me to live pleasingly for you. But if you're listening or watching this and you've never received Jesus, or maybe you did as a child and you've gone off with your life and you've kind of been doing it on your own and you've been running, you know, your own show and you've been kind of just living in your own strength. And if you haven't ever received God's special gift, or it's been a long time and it's grown stale for you, if you've not received God's special gift of forgiveness through Jesus Christ, I got good news for you. This year, he has another special Christmas gift for you. And can I invite you right here, right now, today, right now to receive his love and his forgiveness again, anew, or for the very first time, and accept his invitation to take a place in his family? I don't deserve it. You might feel you don't deserve it. But again, it's not about us. It's about his goodness. And he says, deserve it or not, you need it. And I love giving people what they need instead of what they deserve. And people, I just want you to know, and I want it to be fresh and new this Christmas season, that God loves you with a spectacular love, with an amazing love. And he wants to lavish on you many, many good things, like every loving parent wants to do for their children. And he wants to give you an amazing hope and a future with him. The first theme of the Advent season is hope. And he wants you to live this year and all through your life with the great hope of Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, and your place in the family with him. So let me just ask, would you receive him, the baby Jesus, the Savior of the world, the Prince of Peace and the King of Kings, as your kinsman, redeemer, and Savior today? Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for your great gift of salvation, your great gift of taking my place on the cross and paying for my sins, and your great love. And Lord, I thank you for your word and the Christmas story that helps us see Jesus so clearly and see that he's your promise. He's the one you planned all along to save us and to pay for our sins. So Lord, I just pray that for everyone listening here today, they may not understand it all. Jim doesn't still understand it all for sure. But Lord, may you come into hearts today. May you cleanse us of our mistakes and our sins. May you forgive us. And may you pour your love out upon our watchers and listeners today, especially those who would open their hearts to you this season. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. If you agreed with me, I have great news for you. For today you have joined God's family. And today you have had your sins forgiven. And today you are now safe in the arms of God as his beloved child. Welcome to the family of God. We love having you here. And we're so glad that you joined us today. Amen. Amen. Thank you all, and may God bless you all through this Christmas season. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us today for The Chapel Hour with Reverend Russell Wisehart and the Wisehart Family Singers. For previous programs, please go to YouTube and search for the Wisehart Family Singers channel. If you're a minister, teacher, or student of the Bible and would like to access Reverend Wisehart's messages, outlines, and sermon notes, please go to thechapelhour.blogspot.com. And of course, one of the best ways to stay in touch with us is on the Wisehart Family Singers Facebook page. We want to thank everyone for finding us, for your encouragement, for subscribing to our channel, and for hitting that little like button. We look forward to seeing you next week on The Chapel Hour.